فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، today is going to be the first day of explaining the kitab جلباب المرأة المسلمة في الكتاب والسنة, written by محمد الشيخ العلامة محمد ناصر الدين الألباني. If you have the book with you and you have the طبعة of مكتبة المعارف للنشر والتوزيع, if you go to page 35, which publication do you have? Same one. What do you have, Saad? You have Dar al-Salam. What about yours? He's Dar. Show me. Yours is Dar al-Salam. What about yours? No, what's yours? Dar al-Salam. No, mine is Maktaba al-Ma'arif. It's the same, inshaAllah ta'ala. If you go to page 35, I was meant to get the kitab for today, students, but I promise to get it next week, inshaAllah ta'ala. InshaAllah ta'ala. Page 35, right? What does it say? That's what we want. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. The author starts, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious. He says, مقدمة الطبعة الأولى, the introduction of the first publication. This book got published many times in the life of the author, rahimahullah ta'ala. Sheikh Nasir, he saw the publication of this book many times. It got repeated and it got... And every time what he would do is, he would add a new طبعة to it. طبعة الثانية. And then he would add a new مقدمة الأولى, مقدمة الثانية, and then مقدمة الجديدة. He would add a new introduction in there. And the reason why this book kept getting published again and again and again is that the Shaykh rahimahullah was in a consistent refutation with those who were saying that the niqab is wajib. And the Shaykh holds the opinion that it's not wajib. And he believes those who are saying that it's wajib are very harsh. They are being too tough in a place where they don't need to. He is also saying, alayhi rahmatullahi, that this is not the correct opinion and that that's not the right opinion. So he's pushing that. And so they're responding to him, but he doesn't author a book for them every time. He already did. He wrote a book called Ar-Raddul Mufhim. But this book, he uses the taba'ah that comes out. The next publication, when he works on the book, he adds a little muqaddimah at the front and then he speaks about the arguments and he responds to it there. And that's what Sheikh Nasir started to do in the later stages of his life, if you look at his works. He used to, first of all, author books in refuting those who speak wrong, who speak with no knowledge, whose arguments are weak. He would author a particular book for them, and he would respond to them. But the author, rahimahullah, he reached a point where he thought it was unnecessary to actually start a new book for everybody who speaks. So what he would do is, he would bring their arguments in a book that he's publishing. So he would make a muqaddimah for it, an introduction. And in that introduction, the Sheikh would say what he wanted to say, and he would go into the kitab and say what he wanted. So we're not going to read those 35 pages, because of course the Sheikh here is refuting those who are saying that the niqab is wajib and whatnot, and we are going to see in the book itself. The author starts by saying, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious. Muqaddimah, introduction. At-taba'atil ula, the first publication. So this is the first publication. This is actually what the book was when he first wrote it. The author says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Praises to Allah, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. I mean the Lord of the universe. Al-Qa'ilu fi kitabihi, the one who said in his book, Ya Bani Adam, the children of Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا, we have sent unto you. We have sent unto you عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا, clothing, يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا, clothing for you to cover your private parts with. And also to use it to protect yourselves. Then Allah says, وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ, the clothing of piety is the best. ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ, that is from the verses of Allah. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ, so they may come to remember. So the Shaykh, he starts his book with praising who? Praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what he did was, he did what is known in balagha, he did bara'atul istihlal. Bara'atul istihlal means, when the person is about to talk, they use key terms, they use words that will indicate what they're going to talk about. Scholars, they do that. When they're writing a book, if they're talking about nahu, grammar for instance, they might use terms of grammar at the beginning of their book, at the beginning of their book. So then, as soon as you read it, you know this subject is going to be grammar. Like when Amir Sanani said, حَمْدًا لِمَنْ يُسْنَدُ كُلُّ حَمْدِي إِلَيْهِ مَرْفُوعًا بِغَيْرِ عَدِّي مُتَّصِلًا لَيْسَ لَهُمْ قِطَاعُ مَا فِيهِ كَذَّابٌ وَلَا وَضَّاعُ. This is called bara'atu istihlal. He says, I'm praising Allah, a praise that's connected, that is not disconnected. A praise that is attributed to Him or it's brought back to Him. In that praise, there is no liar in the chain of it. So what is he doing here? He's using hadith terms. He's using marfu', musnad, mawdu', kadhab. This is called bara'atu istihlal. Sheikh Nasir here is doing that. What he's doing is that he's mentioning clothing. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it a blessing for us. And then the author says, وَصَلَّ اللَّهُ, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send salutation عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ, نَبِي اللَّهِ مُحَمَّدٍ الْمَبْعُوثِ, the one that was sent out as رَحْمَةً لِلنَّاسِ. He was sent out as a what? As a rahmah, as a mercy to people. أَجْمَعِينَ, all of them. Then نَبِي اللَّهِ مُحَمَّدٍ is a mercy to mankind. Nabi Allah Muhammad is a what? He is a mercy to mankind. وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ, and on his family. وَصَحْبِهِ, and his companions. So وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ means his family. وَصَحْبِهِ means his what? His companions. وَمَنْ تَبِعَهُمْ, and those who follow them, who follow the companions. بِإِحْسَانٍ, in good. إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, until the day of judgment. So here the author, rahimahullah, he does hamdala, praising Allah. So first he started with the basmala. He said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And then the author came with the hamdala, which is to what? Send praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Him. Then the author, rahimahullah, he sent salutation on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also on the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also on the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those who follow them in good. Salah, the scholars, they differed what is meant by it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does sallallahu mean? Scholars differed. Some said sallallahu means ar-rahma. And others, they said, no, it doesn't mean rahma. It's actually different to rahma. Rahma meaning mercy. Some scholars, they said that the word sallallahu does not mean ar-rahmah, it doesn't mean mercy. And the evidence that they used is the statement of Allah, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. He said, in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He distinguished between the two of them. Look what He said, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ, on them is, أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ, is on them. وَرَحْمَةٌ, and rahmah is on them. So if salah and rahmah were the same, then why is Allah distinguished between the two of them? Ulaika, upon those people is salawatun min rabbihim, salah from Allah is on them. Wa rahma, and pray and mercy of Allah is on them. So the scholars, they said that salah and rahma are different. What is the difference? They said that Salah means Allah is praising the Prophet in the gathering of his angels. Thana'ullahi, the praising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the Prophet fi bala'il a'la, in the high above. He's praising him. He's telling his angels the nobility and the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he's praising the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's the qawl taken by Abu Aliyah al-Rayahi. He's the one who mentioned that. Abu Aliyah said that. That is what Abu Aliyah mentioned, as Bukhari brought it in his Sahih Mu'allaqan. And we take that opinion. And there's a book you can read more into this issue. It's written by Ibn al-Qayyim. It's called Jala'ul Afham fi Fadli Salati ala Khayri al-Anam. Jala'ul Afham fi Fadli Salati ala Khayri al-Anam. Where Ibn al-Qayyim brings all the narrations pertaining to sending salutation on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he talks about the virtue of it. And it's a book worth reading. Amma ba'du, the author then says to proceed. The author says to proceed. فَهَذِهِ رِسَالَة. This is a book, a risala, a little. It's not even a book, he didn't call it. فَهَذِهِ الْكِتَاب. It's فَهَذِهِ الْرِسَالَة. Risala here is a brochure. Okay. Latifatun. It's a good looking brochure. وَبُحُوثٌ مُفِيدَةٌ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And there's good research in it, inshallah ta'ala. The author says, in this brochure, in this little risala, this little message, there's going to be, inshallah, in it, buhuth, good research, beneficial research, inshallah ta'ala. There's going to be in it, وَبُحُوثٌ مُفِيدَةٌ, beneficial research, inshallah ta'ala, if Allah wills. جَمَعْتُهَا, I gathered it. Sheikh Nasir is saying this. I gathered it. لِبَيَانِ اللِّبَاسِ الَّذِي يَجِبُ عَلَى الْمَرْأَةِ الْمُسْلِمَةِ أَن تَدَّثِرَ بِهِ. جَمَعْتُهَا, I gathered in this book. This risala, I gathered in it. لِبَيَانِ اللِّبَاسِ, to explain and to clarify the clothing which is obligatory. الَّذِي يَجِبُ عَلَى الْمَرْأَةِ الْمُسْلِمَةِ, that's obligatory on the Muslim woman, أَنْ تَدَّثِّرَ بِهَا, in which she should cover herself with. إِذَا خَرَجَتْ مِنْ دَارِهَا, when she leaves her house. This book is what? So the author here is explaining, what is this book about? It is about the way that a Muslim woman, it's obligatory on her to dress. And what is it that is upon her to wear? When she what? إِذَا خَرَجَتْ مِنْ دَارِهَا, when she leaves her house. And as you know, there is a difference between when the woman is in her house and when she's outside her house, the clothing she wears. So he's talking about when the woman leaves her house. وَشُرُوطُ الْوَاجِبِ, and the obligatory conditions, تَحَقُّقُهَا فِيهِ, the obligatory conditions that have to be in the hijab. What are the conditions of the hijab? A lot of people say to you, I am wearing a hijab. Sheikh Nasir here is going to explain to you, what is the condition of a hijab? وَشُرُوطُ الْوَاجِبِ تَحَقُّقُهَا فِيهِ حَتَّى يَكُونَ لِبَاسًا إِسْلَامِيًا, so it can become an Islamic clothing. So it can be a what? An Islamic clothing. So what's the aim of this book? And why is the author written this book for? He's written this book for the following. First of all is لِبَيَانِ اللِّبَاسِ, to explain the clothing which is obligatory upon every Muslim woman to cover herself with, إِذَا خَرَجَتْ مِنْ دَارِهَا, one, if she leaves her house. Number two is what? وَشُرُوطُ الْوَاجِبِ, the obligatory conditions that have to be present, حَتَّى يَكُونَ لِبَاسًا إِسْلَامِيًا, so it can be an Islamic clothing. Those are the two things that he authored this book for. وَاسْتَنَدْتُ فِي ذَٰلِكَ عَلَى الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. Now the author is going to mention to us, how is he going to prove? alayhi rahmatullahi, how is he going to prove what is the conditions and what is obligatory upon the Muslim woman to dress herself with? Because to say this is obligatory, that a woman has to wear this, what is it? It's a hukum shar'i. It's a legislation from who? From Allah. Allah is the only one who can say this is obligatory. And only Allah can say this is haram. And only Allah can say this is permissible. La Sheikh Nasir can say that. No other than Sheikh Nasir can't say that. That's something only Allah and His Messenger can say. So Sheikh Nasir saying, where I'm getting from what is obligatory on the woman and what she has to wear, واستندت في ذلك, I have used and I have leaned on على الكتاب والسنة. I've used the kitab and the sunnah as my reference point. I will get everything which I say. Every ruling I bring, I'm going to bring the Quran for this, and I'm also going to bring the sunnah for this. That's what he said. Is he going to be right in some places? Na'am. La shakka wa la raib. The Sheikh, he is. But there are things that we are also going to differ with him and disagree with the Sheikh and not accept it. And we will challenge him in it. When it comes to the points that he brings regarding the jilbab and the face veil, we will argue against his belief. And then it leaves you all upon your choices. If you want to then be inclined to the opinion of Sheikh Nasir, or if you want to be inclined to the opinion of those scholars who said it's obligatory for the woman to cover her face. But we will bring both parties and we won't be biased. Inshallah ta'ala. I hope so. وَاسْتَنَدْتُ فِي ذَٰلِكَ, I have referenced and I have used as in my argument in proving what's obligatory on the woman to wear when she leaves her house and the conditions of what is obligatory for the clothing to be an Islamic clothing, I have used the kitab. And I've also used the sunnah for this. مُسْتَرْشِدًا بِمَا وَرَدَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْأَثَارِ. Mustarshidan means what? Looking for guidance. Through what? Bima warada fihi min athari. So he's using the Quran. And then he's using the Sunnah. And then Sheikh Nasir is saying, I'm also going to try to find guidance through. Bima warada min athari wa aqwali min as-sahabati wal a'imma. Statements that have been transmitted, that have been brought forward from the companions and the Imams of Islam. The ulama, the fuqaha, the jurists, statements that they've said, I'm also going to use them as evidence. Evidence to the understanding of the kitab and the sunnah. Not evidences that are in that these, their statements independently, it's a proof. No, it's not. No one's statement is independently a proof. Are you there? But we respect the ulama's understanding. What we respect is what? Their understanding of the text, the kitab and the sunnah. So the Shaykh here, rahimahullah, that's his path in this issue of jilbab. Is there anything else a Muslim can want in knowing the ruling of a matter through the kitab and the sunnah and the athar, the texts that have been transmitted to you from the statements of the companions and the students of the companions and the imams of Islam? Is there anything better than that? That's how it should be. That's how every person who wants to bring forward a ruling in Islam has to take. It's not about emotions. It's not about how you feel. What is it? The issue of the ruling of a matter is based on that. It's based upon al-kitab, wa-sunnah, and wa-bima warada min al-athari an al-sahabati wal-a'imma. So it's the Quran and the sunnah and the statements that have come from the companions and the scholars of Islam. That's what Sheikh Nasir is going to, rahimahullah, is going to say. Now the Sheikh moves on to saying, فَإِنْ أَصَبْتُ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَلَهُ الْفَضْلُ وَالْمِنَّةِ. If I get it right, to show you that the ulama don't believe in any way, form or shape that they are infallible, that they are errorless. Sheikh Nasir is saying, فَإِنْ أَصَبْتُ, if I get it right, in what I bring forward, if my arguments are correct and it's in accordance to what it should be in the kitab and the sunnah, فَمِنَ اللَّهِ, it is only from Allah. It's not me. Even if I get it right, who is the praise going to go back to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَهُ الْفَضْلُ and the virtue. وَلَهُ الْفَضْلُ and the virtue is with what? Is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالْمِنَّةِ and praise and virtue is with him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is virtuous in that. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? This again shows you the humility of the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, and that the truth, you don't believe that you're the one who's carrying the banner of the truth. Are you there? You yourself can be wrong sometimes. You can get things wrong. Shaykh Nasir rahimahullah ta'ala, he has masail hadithiyya, matters of hadith, he himself came back from. Taraju'at al-Albani. He authored works where he takes a hadith from his silsil ahadith al-da'ifa, where he weakened it, and then years in his life, it came clear to him that they're not weak narrations, they're actually authentic. So what did he do? He moved it from his sahih, and he placed it in his what? From his da'if to his sahih. Are you there? And his students, they came after him, and what they did was, they actually, they wrote books on Albani coming back from some narrations. ولذلك sometimes you do see people who say Sheikh Nasir authenticated this hadith. And when you look at it, it was what he authenticated in the beginning. It's what he authenticated in the beginning and that he came back from. From the hadith he weakened and he authenticated later. Or he authenticated and then he weakened. So if Sheikh Nasir himself is coming back from his own views, and you know it's harder for a person to come back from their own views, then would it be a problem if somebody differs with Sheikh Nasir? No. It's right and it's legit for anyone to differ with him in authentication. Are you with me? There's no book on the face of this earth that we say it's 100% right, except the book of Allah. Sahih? The book of Allah is the only book that Allah says in the Quran, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Do they not ponder on the Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ If it was from other than Allah, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا You find contradiction in it. صح? If the Quran was to come from anyone other than Allah, it would contradict itself. Then a scholar is bound to do mistakes. That the reason why his book is going to have a mistake is because if it's all right, then what would be the difference between that book and the Quran? There has to be a miza. There has to be that distinct status for the Quran that no other books carry. And then every single book is mu'arradu lil khata. Every book that you find, it's open for mistakes. And everybody who speaks is open for mistakes. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? So when we say that, this, but what we don't do is, and this is what people always fall into, that when they say this person got it wrong, they think that puts his status down. No, it doesn't. It doesn't put the person's status down. He's an imam. Imam Sheikh Nasir is an imam. Alim min ulama al-Muslimin. But he has mistakes. There are things that we're going to say he got this wrong. We're not going to say it, of course. We're not on a level to say that about him. Or that caliber to say that about him. Are you with me? But we're going to reference other ulama who've corrected him in issues. And we're going to look between what these ulama have said and what he has said, and we'll take which of those is in accordance and more closer to the evidence, or is in line of the evidence. And he himself, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy onto him, is saying, فَإِنْ أَصَبْتُ If I get it right, فَمِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى It's only from Allah. وَلَهُ الْفَضْلُ وَالْمِنَّةِ But when you differ with Sheikh Nasir, don't differ with him because of emotions. Not only Sheikh Nasir, but any Imam in A'immat al-Muslimin, Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad. If you do differ with them in a mas'ala, differ with them based on knowledge and proof. Not awatif, not based on emotions in which you have. The Shaykh then says, وَإِن كَانَتِ الْأُخْرَى If it's the opposite, meaning I get it right. If I get it wrong. So he said, if I get it right, it's from Allah alone, and he's the one who's got the virtue for that. But what about if I get it wrong? فَذَٰلِكَ مِنِّي The mistake is from me. The fault is attributed to me. The good, did he attribute to himself? Who did he attribute it to? That's a characteristic of a believer. When calamity is before you and you go through a hardship, who should you blame? Blame yourself. Don't blame Allah. When the Muslims are getting harmed in a particular land in the world, whether it be Syria or Somalia or the Rohingyas, we don't blame Allah. We do not blame Allah. Who do we blame? We blame ourselves. We bring the finger of blame directly at ourselves. And we don't attribute it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these atrocities. Why? Because Allah has a sunan, He has ways, He has a path. لا تتبدل ولا تتغير, that doesn't change. That doesn't change, which is ذلك بما قدمت أيديكم. That is what your hands have put forward. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person does a mistake, that mistake can't just go in the air and go. It has to have a consequences. Things have consequences. The lying that you lied yesterday, the wrongdoing that you did yesterday, the crimes that you're committing, they have to have what? Have to have consequences. They have to have what? Consequences. They have to have consequences. The Shaykh says, وَإِن كَانَتِ الْأُخْرَىٰ, if I do a mistake, فَدَالِكَ مِنِّي, it's from me. The mistake is from me. وَأَسْأَلُهُ الْعَفْوَىٰ, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. وَالْمَغْفِرَةَ لِذَنْبِي, and that He forgives me for my sins. عَفْو and الْمَغْفِرَةَ, what's the difference? العَفْو is when you're forgiven and it's not written for you. الْمَغْفِرَةَ is when it's forgiven but it's still written for you. لِذَنْبِي, forgive me for my sins, O Allah. إِنَّهُ عَفُوٌ كَرِيمٌ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah is one that's forgiving, generous. And He's one who's forgiven, which is gracious and merciful to His creation. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness of these mistakes that he might do, that might occur from him, alayhi rahmatullah. Now the author is saying, why did he author this book? What made him write the book in the first place? What made him want to write about the issue pertaining to the women's jilbab? Are you with me? What brought this idea to him? Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, he said, وَقَدْ كَانَ ذَلِكَ بِطَلَبٍ مِنْ بَعْضِ الْإِخْوَانِ الْأَحِبَّةِ. He said, and this was a request from some noble, beloved brothers who requested from me the authorship of this book. And the writing of this book is with what? It is بِطَلَب, it's from a request. مِن بَعْضِ الْإِخْوَانِ, some brothers they've requested from me. الْأَحِبَّةِ, that are beloved to me. They requested from me. الَّذِي نَظُنُّ فِيهِمُ الصَّلَاحَ وَالْإِسْتِقَامَةِ, in which we believe regarding them that they are righteous and that they are steadfast and upright. That's what we believe of them. We believe they are people, أهل الصلاح, people who are righteous. We believe of them that they are people who are of piety. The ones who have requested from me. وَالْحِرْصَ عَلَى الْعَمَلِ بِمَا يَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابُ وَالسُّنَّةِ. And what we also believe of them is that they strive, these individuals, to implement that which the Kitab and the Sunnah show. They are a people who we know of them, piety and nobility. We also know of them implementing what the Qur'an and the Sunnah does. So they want to know any issue. What does the Qur'an and the Sunnah say regarding it? Because they want to go and implement it. That's what we know of these people who are asking me, he says. وَقَدْ دَنَا يَوْمَ زِفَافِهِ. And the day of his wedding has become very close, one of them. جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ, may Allah make it مُبَارَكًا, full of blessings. عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَىٰ أَهْلِ, on him and his family. وَذُرِّيَّتِهِ, and his offspring. So Sheikh Nasir was requested. He was asked, and this is something you find very common. Scholars, they author a book, they put some treaty together, they will put a risala together. And why would they do that? Because they got requested from them. Somebody came and said, can you author this? And this is to show you that the ulama live with the people. They're not living in the mood. They know the people's problems. They know what the people are suffering from. They speak about the contemporary issues that the people are suffering from. They have a majal in it. But they don't speak about it like politicians. The people of knowledge don't speak about issues like politicians and say this is the statistics, this is, they don't do that. They go back to the Quran and the Sunnah and the way that the Quran and Sunnah has spoken about this particular issue. Are you with me? So Sheikh Nasir says, وَقَدَّلَ يَوْمُ زِفَافِهِ يَوْمَ زِفَافِهِ sorry جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ مُبَارَكًا عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ وَذُرِّيَّتِهِ فَرَأَيْتُ مِنَ الْوَاجِبِ أَنْ أُبَادِرَ إِلَىٰ إِجَابَةِ طَلَبِهِ وَتَحْقِيقَ رَغْبَتِهِ. Sheikh Nasir then said, فَرَأَيْتُ I saw binding on myself الْوَاجِبِ I saw that it was obligatory and mandatory أَنْ أُبَادِرَ إِلَىٰ إِجَابَةِ طَلَبِهِ that I what? I answer the request that they put forward. That now I come and I do what they asked me for. وَتَحْقِيقِ رَغْبَتِي and specifically this individual whose wedding is about to be closed, that I fulfill his desires, what he wants. عَلَى الرَّغْمِ مِنْ ضِيقِ وَقْتِي even that though, my time is so tight. Sheikh Nasir رحمه الله تعالى, his time was like that. We mentioned yesterday, he was an individual whose minutes, his seconds, they all counted for him. Are you with me? I told you this before, Sheikh Nasir, if he ever got invited at weddings, he would take his books with him. If he got invited at weddings, he would take his books. And what he would do is, he would take his pen and paper out, alayhi rahmatullah, and he would write the content page for his book. He would use that moment to write the faharas of his kitab, the content page for his book. That's what he would do. And he would say, this is my time of enjoyment. I'm enjoying myself. Because writing the fahras for him is minor compared to how he has to spend so much time looking at manuscripts and going into books that are not published, they're handwritten. He's looking at them. And he's looking at each narrator, his name. And narrators' names are very close in writing, trying to be accurate that he's writing the right name. Are you with me? So he said, my time is very tight. Like he's, Sheikh Nasir has a schedule. He's got a project that he's in front of him. He's going to mention it. That he's trying to accomplish. And then people are asking him to do things. He still has time to fulfill their needs. He said, وَتَحْقِيقُ رَغْبَتِي عَلَى الرَّغْمِ مِنْ ضِيقِ وَقْتِي My time is very tight. وَانْصِرَافِي إِلَى الْعَمَلِ فِي مَشْرُوعِي And I have turned, meaning I did insiraf, I'm turned towards my project which I have put forward. There's a project which I'm doing. الَّذِي أَسْمَيْتُهُ which I called it تَقْرِيبُ السُّنَّةِ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ الْأُمَّةِ I called this project bringing the sunnah close to the ummah and placing it in front of the ummah. I called this project, Sheikh Nasir is saying this, I've embarked on an effort and on a project that I'm doing which I called it تَقْرِيبُ السُّنَّةِ bringing the sunnah close. بَيْنَ يَدَيِ الْأُمَّةِ in front of the ummah. That's a project I embarked on. What was this project? It was to work on the four books of the Sunan. Sunan Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i. Are you with me? That was the project that he embarked on, alayhi rahmatullah. Did he finish it and do it? He did it, rahimahullah ta'ala. He worked on each and every one of them. Naam, Sheikh Nasir. تقريب السنة بين يدي الأمة الذي شرعت فيه منذ سنتين وزيادة. And he said, I embarked on it منذ سنتين وزيادة. 2 years and more. 2 years and more, I've been doing that. That's all I've been doing. مبتدئ and I started with Sunan Abi Dawood. Allahu Akbar. People would sometimes say to you, Sheikh Nasir doesn't have fiqh. He doesn't have what? He doesn't have fiqh. The great scholar, the great Maliki scholar, Ibn al-Arabi, al-Mu'arrafi bil-Alif wal-Lam, he said, if a person was only with the Mus'haf, and Sunan Abi Dawood, there would be no other book he would be in need of. Person Sunan Abi Dawood, and he has the Mus'haf, the Qur'an, and he knows the Qur'an, he's got that with him, and he has the Sunan Abi Dawood, that's it. You know why? What is it that everybody needs? Al-Kitabu? Al-Sunnah. And Sunan Abi Dawood is the best book in fiqh, even better than Bukhari and Muslim. Sunan Abi Dawood is better. The hadith that are in there are purely what? Fiqh related hadith. So Sheikh Nasir has to come, work on the narrations, authenticating it, looking at it, checking it, verifying the wordings are right. This is as accurate as the Prophet said it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Of course the Sheikh has fiqh. Of course he has fiqh. He started with that. And guess what did he do? He took Sunan Abi Dawud, he divided a hadith which are da'if in one place and he called it da'if Sunan Abi Dawud. And then he went and he authored Sahih Sunan Abi Dawud. A hadith which are Sahih Sunan Abi Dawud, he put it in one place. And the hadith which were da'if of Sunan Abi Dawud, he put it in one place. Alayhi rahmatullah. And then after that, his student, Sheikh Mashur Hassan, what he did was, he brought the Sunan Abi Dawud, are you there? The actual Sunan Abi Dawud, all the hadith the way they are, just the matan of the hadith, and each hadith he just placed da'if and sahih in red, in brackets, just to know what Sheikh Nasir said about it. And he then tells you the reference point of if you want to look more into it, why it's weak or sahih. Some people don't want to, they just want to know is it sahih or da'if. That's all they want to know, right? So what did he do? He placed in brackets before the hadith, da'if, sahih. Are you there? And you go back and you can check why it's sahih or da'if. Mubtadi, and I started my project with the project called Taqreeb Sunnah. Bayna yaday al-umma. I started with Sunnah Abi Dawood. Thumma tawakkaftu anhu. Then I withheld from this. I stopped this project. منذ أشهر for a couple of months now. Why? لعارض طرأ على عين اليمنى. A problem occurred on my right eye. One of my right eyes, Sheikh Nasir was having a problem with it. So the doctor said to him, if you want the problem to go, you would have to stop reading, to relax, take it easy on yourself. What you're doing is what's going to kill you. And Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah, he said, no, what's going to kill me is stop doing that. What's going to kill me is when I stop doing it. So what he did was, he didn't stop the projects that he was doing in totality and the works that he was doing, but anything that involved long research and that involved looking deep, he paused for a little bit. And he did the simple stuff, like writing this book.